volume of dirt that's being dumped at a particular rate.
So in reading the question we first identify, that's giving us a rate of change. This rate is the rate of change of volume, so it's V prime, dV by dt. And it says that the dirt is being dumped out and it's forming the shape of a cone whose base diameter and height are always equal to each other. So I'll draw a picture of that cone. Here's the cone of dirt. It has a circular base. There's a radius r. And here's the height h. I did not draw it to scale. Or does it say, let's see, diameter and height, not radius and height, diameter. So diameter is equal to 2 times the radius. So we can write in here that 2 times r is equal to h. That's using the fact that base diameter and height are always equal to each other. And the question wants, how fast is the height increasing? Use a different color for that. How fast is the height of the pile increasing when the pile is 10 feet high? So that's asking, what is dh by dt, what is h prime when h is equal to 10? And it finally gives a hint that the volume is pi r squared h. So volume is pi r squared times h. So let's write everything in terms of h. Let's write the volume in terms of h and get rid of the r term. We can isolate the 2r is equal to h. We can isolate that for r. R is equal to h divided by 2. Divide both sides by 2. And then rewrite the volume expression completely in terms of r, or rather completely in terms of h. So r squared gets replaced by h over 2 all squared, and the h stays. So our volume is pi h cubed over 2. Oh, over 4. Forgot to square the 2. Questions at this point? We haven't used the rate of change yet. We haven't used that h is equal to 10. We haven't used what v prime is. We have not taken any derivatives. All that's been done is the expression for, there's a mistake. There's a typo. Typo is for a cone, its volume should be that expression divided by 3. In your quiz, I corrected it, and I forgot to correct it on here. So there's a pi over 3. So there should be pi over 12. Now that's better.
So the original expression for the volume of the cone has been rewritten using the fact that the diameter twice the radius is equal to the height. Now this entire expression is completely in terms of the height.
Now we're going to take the derivative of both sides. Keeping in mind that h is a function of t. So h cubed, you can think of that as a function to the power of 3. I'll put that function all in brackets. You can take the derivative of a function to the power of 3. The 3 comes down. You have that function raised to the power of 2 multiplied by the derivative of the inside, which is h prime. So I'll differentiate both sides. V prime is equal to pi over 12 times 3 times h squared times h prime. So there's a 3 on top, a 12 on the bottom. We can do some canceling. This is pi over 4 times h squared times h prime. Next step, we can use the information from the question that says h is equal to 10 and v prime is equal to 30. So 30 is equal to pi over 4 times 10 squared times h prime. Cross multiply the 4 up to the left hand side, so we have 120 is equal to 100 pi times h prime. So finally, h prime is equal to 120 divided by 100 pi. You can divide top and bottom by 10. That's 12 over 10 pi. And then divide top and bottom by 2. So that would be 6 over 5 pi. So we want to simplify it. Let me make sure it was at what rate is increasing. Yes, the volume is positive, rate of change of volume is positive. It's at dirt is being added. So the fact this is a positive quantity is reassuring. Questions about any of the steps for this example? Again, this is from quiz 5, question number 3. Or question number 1 if you're writing the other code. This is a question from what year?
Uh, 2014
final exam. Number 20. Okay. So it's asking for the derivative d by dx of the integral from e to the power of x to 1 of ln of t dt. And to solve this question, there's two ways to do it. One of them is to actually integrate ln of t. It's possible to integrate that function. It requires a strategy of integration called integration by parts, which is not part of Calculus 1000. So that means the only way to do this, if you can't directly integrate the function, you have to use what's called the fundamental theorem of calculus. I'll write that down. And it states that the derivative, d by dx, of the integral from g of x to h of x of f of t dt is equal to f of h multiplied by h prime minus f of g times g prime. What's going on is this.
Taking the antiderivative of ln of t will give you a new function. You plug in 1 into the new function, you plug in e to the x into the new function. Then the next instruction is take the derivative of that result. When you take the derivative of that new function, you're in a sense going back to your original function. You're undoing the derivative derivative and antiderivative are inverse operations in a sense. They're almost inverses. You're going to go back to your original function, multiply, evaluated at the endpoints, multiplied by the derivative of the endpoints from the chain rule.
And I put a video on OWL that goes through some proofs of that and some examples of that, doing these kinds of questions the long way, where you actually integrate it, and then showing that it's the same as using the fundamental theorem. So to use the fundamental theorem directly, we'll write this as ln of the top, ln of 1, multiplied by the derivative of 1. What's the derivative of 1? 0. Minus ln of e to the x, multiplied by the derivative of e to the x, which is e to the x. I'll just circle that 0, that's the h prime, and this e to the x, that's the g prime. Okay, so we have 0 from the first piece, minus ln of e to the x, there's a cancellation law, that's just x, times e to the x. So we get negative x, e to the x as our answer. Questions about this? If you're curious, antiderivative of ln of x, that's x ln of x minus x plus c. You could plug this in for your antiderivative, evaluate it on the bounds, take the derivative, and you get this back. It's a way of not having to integrate the function. And it only works You can't do this unless you have this d by dx in front. You have to have the derivative of the antiderivative to use fundamental theorem of calculus in this form. So A3 from 2015 exam. It's asking for the integral from negative 2 to 2 of, where is it? E to the negative x squared times sine of x. Okay, something to have in mind when you're doing integration. If it looks like a really hard integral to solve, there's no derivative in front. Look for an opportunity to use this trick. The integral from negative a to a of an odd function equals zero. So the picture of why this is true looks as follows. Here's your graph. Here's your x and y axis, x versus y, and here's your graph of the function. So this is what an odd function looks like. I'll just draw some general odd function. It's a mirror image. Left and right side are supposed to be mirror images of each other and flip. So the mirror left and right, and the mirror top and bottom. And what the integral from negative a to a gives you, here's negative a, and well, it's all not a very good drawing, but this region from negative a to 0 is going to give you a negative contribution to the integral, and this region from 0 to a will give you a positive contribution to the integral, and both are equal in magnitude. When you add both together, you're going to get 0. So I'll call this one negative a, and this one positive a. And the integral from negative a to a will be negative capital A plus positive capital A, which is 0. So it's not really a proof of it, but it's a graphical description of why it's true. So in order to use this property, we have to check, is f of x odd? So I'll remind you what the definition of an odd function is. F of x is odd if f of negative x is equal to the negative of f of x. And odd functions include f of x equals sine of x is an odd function, f of x equals x is an odd function, f of x equals x cubed is an odd function, f of x equals tan of x is an odd function. There's a whole list of them. If it was e to the negative x times sine of x, yes. But the e to the negative x squared, no.
Did you drag out the 2 or no?
Mm-mm. No, it won't work. They set it up so you can't integrate it. The integral of this function is by integration by parts, but you need a new function that you haven't seen before to pose as the answer. So you can't directly integrate it.
So if it has like the x squared, then you just don't want to integrate it?
There's an exception to every rule. Integral of x times e to the x squared dx. You can integrate this one. You can do a substitution, let u equal x squared. And then that dx will be replaced by du divided by x. And the x's will cancel, and then you can integrate e to the u. So you can integrate that one, but so I don't want to mislead you to say that every time you see something that looks really hard to integrate, you can't integrate it. But for Calc 1000, if it looks really hard to integrate, the answer is probably zero. Probably. Don't quote me on that. Because sometimes it's not zero. It could be all kinds of things. But you don't have a big pile of integration strategies. You don't have integration by parts. You don't have inverse trig substitutions. You don't have any of the big ones for integrating tough functions. All you have is substitution. So however, that hasn't stopped them from giving tough integration questions. Anyway, so let's check. Is this function odd?
So what is f of x? Our function we're integrating is e to the negative x squared times the sine of x. Now let's replace all the x's with negative x's. So of e to the negative bracket, negative x all squared, times the sine of negative x. And that's e to the negative positive x squared times the negative sine of positive x. The sine of x is odd. And then we can take the negative sine that's in front of the sine of x and put it in front of the whole function. Negative e to the negative x squared times the sine of x, which is the negative of f of x. So that means the function's odd. That means we have the integral from negative 2 to 2 of an odd function, which is 0.
If in doubt, do this. Check that it's, don't just say it's 0 because it looks hard. Sometimes there is a trick, like a substitution trick. Like this one. Integral of e to the negative cos squared of x times the sine of x. No? Can't do that one. Negative sine squared of x times sine of x cos of x dx. You can integrate that. So that u equal negative sine squared of x, then du by dx is negative 2 sine of x times cosine of x. Isolate for dx. Dx is equal to negative du divided by 2 sine of x cosine of x. Substitute that dx in here. The sine of x cosine of x cancels. You'll have negative 1/2, so that 2 downstairs, the negative sign in front of the integral. Integral of e to the u du. That's negative 1/2. And the derivative of e to the u is e to the u plus c. And then at the end, replace u with negative sine squared of x. And that'll be your answer. So some of these really nasty ones can be integrated, but they're set up to use substitution.
Just because it's nasty doesn't mean it's zero, but it could be. It could be by symmetry. More questions?
Okay, 2014, number 17. And it says delta x is equal to 4 divided by n, and x sub I is equal to 2 plus I delta x. Then what is the limit? It says find an expression that's equivalent to the limit as n approaches infinity of the sum from I equals 1 to n of x sub I times the cos of 1 plus x sub I dx.
Oh, is that dx or delta x? It can't be ds. It has to be delta x.
Okay, so what we're going to do is do some substitution,
replace the delta x down there with the 4 grand, and replace this x sub I with 2 plus I delta x.
This is one of the nicer ones. When as n approaches infinity of the sum from I, I think so. I haven't looked at the answers yet. Then we have 2 plus 4i over n. So 2, that's x sub I is being replaced with 2 plus I delta x. So we have 2 plus 4i over n. Multiplied by the cos of 1 plus 2 plus 4i over n. So this is the limit as n approaches infinity of the sum from I equals 1 to n. Oh, I see the first sign of problems. I'm sure I copied that right. What?
Everything in there is 1, and there's nothing multiplied by the coefficient of I.
Okay, you don't have to do that. Let's just leave it. Forget I said that. Don't do that. It's not helpful. Instead, we'll just look directly at the form of the expression. So, an integral from a to b of f of x dx has the general form. A Riemann integral has the general form as follows: limit as n approaches infinity of the sum from I equals 1 to n of delta x times f of x sub I, where delta x is equal to b minus a over n, and x sub I is equal to a plus I delta x. So let's compare the x sub I here with the x sub I here in the general formulas. Comparing those two, a must be equal to 2. Now let's compare the delta x's. So this delta x of b minus a over n has to be equal to this delta x of 4 over n. So 4 over n has to equal b minus a over n. The n's cancel. 4 has to be equal to b minus a, but a is 2. So 4 is equal to b minus 2. Add 2 to both sides. B is equal to 6. So we have those two facts. That allows us to write our integral as the integral from 2 to 6 of f of x dx. What is f of x? From the other from the expression, but inside the limit. It's the next thing. The color. So this stuff in here, x sub I times the cos of 1 plus x sub I, that has to be f of x sub I. So write that down. F of x sub I is equal to x sub I times the cos of 1 plus x sub I. Questions to here? A lot of stuff went on here.
I made a mistake at the beginning, not really a mistake, but it was unnecessary work of subbing stuff in, and I realized, well, usually they make us do the reverse. They give us the expression where things have already been subbed in, we could work backwards to that step. So there's no point doing that. So this is f of the variable is equal to the variable times the cos of 1 plus the variable. To get what f of x is, just replace the x sub i's with x's.
So f of x is equal to x times the cos of 1 plus x. Just replace x sub I with x. And that allows us finally to write the integral as the integral from 2 to 6 of x times the cos of 1 plus x dx.
And if you want to solve that integral, if you want it to actually complete this question and get a clear answer, you're going to want to do substitution first, like 1 plus x, then write x as 1 minus u, we're going to have one expression using it straight directly, and another expression using called integration by parts form. It's a hard question to solve.
This is
almost exactly the same example from the calculus 1301 midterm line. I think it's more than x times the log of 1 plus x, or times price times sine of 1 plus x, something along those lines. So it's not integrated in our top 1000 expression, that's the calculus 1301.
But to convert from a sum to an integral, that's calculus 1000. Questions? Let me look at the other choices.
Possibly by accident. Someone could put a question in that you could solve directly by accident instead of using the fundamental theorem of calculus. For example, right? So here's an FTP question. Derivative of an antiderivative evaluated on bounds and it's supposed to be impossible to integrate. They say, hey, NYBP. So you integrate it, plug in the bounds, take the derivative, get the same result that fundamental theorem would tell you. There's no real, I guess in a sense it's an advantage to know it, but it would be by accident. The test would never be designed purposefully. Yeah. Yeah. It'd be a very happy accident for anyone who knew it. Yeah.
Okay, again, the question number 9 for 6.2 gave us two curves, y squared is equal to x, and x is equal to 2y. That part did not tell me to swap the x's and y's. What told me to swap the x's and y's is the fact that it's rotated about the y-axis. So we swap all the variables and then solve the new question, which is just a relabeling. We're just changing the labels of the axes. So I'll make a sketch next. Your y-axis, your x-axis. Let's check to see where they cross. We'll set both functions equal to each other. So x squared is equal to 2x. Bring the 2x to the other side. X squared minus 2x is equal to 0. Common factor out the x. We have x times x minus 2 is equal to 0. So two solutions. X is 0 and x is 2. Okay, next we'll make our sketch. So for y is equal to x squared, that's a parabola facing up. There's another piece on the left-hand side, but it won't matter. And then for y is equal to 2x, that's a straight line of slope 2. Intercept 0. And it has a piece on the left, but that piece doesn't matter. So we're taking this region. And rotating it about the x-axis. It'll give us this kind of a shape. And notice that there's a hole in the middle.
When you rotate this around, there's going to be a gap. There's going to be a place where you put ice cream. You're going to take this and flip it on the side, put ice cream inside. So to construct this volume, we're going to need washers.
So here's your 3D shape. You have a solid cross section and a hole in the middle. If you were to take that shape and cut it, you'd get slices like these, each slice with a hole in the middle. If you take that slice and turn it on its side and face the slice towards you, it's going to look like this. It's going to look like a circle with a circular hole in the middle. Now we'll label the pieces. From the center of the circle to the outside edge, call that capital R. And from the picture, capital R is equal to the y value of that orange line, which is 2x. The other radius for the inside hole from the other picture, so that's little r
is the y value of the purple curve, which is x squared.
Questions about the geometry so far?
The reason why we need these,
the big radius, oh, supposed to be the large,
the big radius and little radius, is for all volume questions, our area, or rather our volume, is going to be the integral from A to B of an area function. A of x dx, if we're integrating the x direction, for slices and the thickness of delta x, or A of y dy, for slices and the function, or for slices and the thickness in the y direction, like the way the question was originally set up before we switched the variables. Now, A of x is the area of each of these cross sections. The area of the big circle is pi times big R squared. The area of the little circle is pi times little r squared. The area of this region that is shaded in up there, that's going to be the area of the big circle minus the area of the little circle. So it'll be pi times capital R squared minus little r squared. That's the area of the front of a washer. Now substitute in the expressions for big R and little r. Big R is 2x, so that'll be 4x squared. And little r is x squared, so that'll be x squared squared, which is x to the power 4. What's a and b? Where are we integrating from? 0 to 2, from the lowest x value to the highest x value, and we got those from the crossing points. So we did need those. So this will be integral from 0 to 2. Put the pi in front of the integral, it's a constant, of 4x squared minus x to the power 4 dx. Questions to this point? Go back and re-explain anything that happened above.
So it's easier to draw. Easier to draw the picture.
Not really drawn by it.
Yeah.
Oh, you mean like the diagram?
Yeah, because if you don't switch it, then you're graphing, instead of y is equal to x squared, you're graphing x is equal to y squared. So it's going to be a parabola on the side.
Yeah.
And the line is still a line. That one's okay to draw. And then, but instead of top function minus bottom function, it's going to be right function minus left function. So it's okay, you can leave it. I just find it very hard to draw, especially when this trig functions here. Imagine trying to draw x equals sine of y from 0 to pi over 2. That's hard to picture, which is going to go this way. Right? I find it very hard to visualize those. So that's the real reason why I switched the x's and y's, because I really want to make this picture. If I didn't care about making the picture, then we could just leave it as y in terms of x. It would. You have to be careful that you don't throw away solutions, right? So y squared is equal to x is y equals plus or minus the root of x. So when you're setting them equal to each other and solving, you want to make sure that you capture all the solutions. Sometimes you get two solutions, right? Sometimes you get, not in this case, but in some cases you get three. And by getting rid of, by changing a square into a square root and keeping either the plus or the minus, sometimes you've now you've eliminated some of those solutions. So you have to be cautious doing that. If it's cubed, that's perfectly fine. Okay, now we'll integrate this. Antiderivative of 4x squared is 4x cubed divided by 3. Antiderivative of x to the 4 is x to the 5 divided by 5. And then we plug in from 0 to 2. If you plug 2 in, you're going to have 4 times 8, so 32 on top, divided by 3, minus 2 to the power 5, which is 32 divided by 5, minus, plug in the bottom bound, we'll have 0 minus 0.
since the bottom bound is 0. Now we need to do some multiplying.
Multiply top and bottom of the first by 5. So that will be
160. Over 3. Multiply top and bottom of the second one by 3. So that'll be 96. Oh, sorry, not over 3, over 15. 15, 96 over 15, and then subtract. So that's going to be 64 pi divided by 15. Does that reduce? Can you divide? Can't divide by 5. Can you divide by 3? No, can't. Oh, wait, can you? 30, no, you can't. Never mind. I think for this one, if you do isolate right away, if you write y equals positive square root of x and y equals x over 2 and set it up that way, you'll get the same answer because you're not going to be throwing away any solutions to the crossing point. So B29 part A. And this is from the 2014 exam. It asks for the limit as x approaches 0. It should be 0 plus. I think there's a typo. Please correct it to 0 plus. Otherwise, you have 1 to the negative infinity. Well, it's still okay, but they shouldn't really leave that ambiguity there. 1 plus 3x to the 1 over x. And this is of the form 1 to the power of infinity. If you let x be 0, you're going to have 1 plus 0 to the power of 1 over 0 plus. 1 over 0 plus is, you can just say that goes to infinity. 1 over x goes to infinity as x goes to 0 plus. So we'll call the solution to this y. We'll say y is equal to the value that we're after. Or we can say capital A if you want. Capital A is equal to the value that we're after. The answer. Just give it a name. Now we'll ln both sides. So a ln of our answer. And we'll bring the ln into the limit. We'll live dangerously and do that without worrying. 1 plus 3x to the power of 1 over x.
The reason we're taking the log on both sides is because we can't use L'Hopital's rule or anything like it in the existing format. Now it's possible that we'll be able to rearrange the function on the right in order to be able to use L'Hopital's rule.
The way that we'll do that is we'll use a log property. The ln of a to the power of c is c times the ln of a. Power comes down. So ln of a is equal to limit as x approaches 0 plus of 1 over x multiplied by the ln of 1 plus 3x. And now we'll use a multiplication property. If you have, let's say, 1 over a multiplied by b, you can write that as b divided by a. It's a kind of an obvious property, but when you're looking at something like this, it might not be so obvious. We still have ln of a on the left. We don't have a. We have ln of a equals the limit as x approaches 0 plus of the ln of 1 plus 3x all over x. Now this is nice because if we plug 0 in for x, this looks like ln of 1 plus 0 divided by 0. And what's the ln of 1? 0. So this is 0 over 0. That's definite cause for celebration. Because it allows us to use L'Hopital's rule. We still have ln of a on the left. Now we use L'Hopital's rule on the right. Then as x approaches 0 plus,
L'Hopital's rule tells us if we have 0 over 0 over infinity as the home of our limit, we can take the derivative of the top and the derivative of the bottom separately, independently of each other, not using the quotient rule, separate derivatives, and then reevaluate the limit and see if it's possible to get an answer. So on the bottom we have the derivative of x, which is 1. On the top we have the derivative of log function. Off to the side, reminder how to do derivatives of logs. If, let's say, our function h is equal to ln of u, then h prime is u prime divided by u from the chain rule. We have 1 over u, derivative of ln of x is 1 over x, derivative of ln of u is 1 over u, then multiplied by u prime from the derivative of the inside from that chain rule. So for this particular function, we're going to have top and the bottom piece from that derivative. Downstairs we'll have the original function, 1 plus 3x, and upstairs we have the derivative of 1 plus 3x, which is 0 plus 3. Questions to this point? Okay, we still have ln of a on the left. Limit as x approaches 0 plus of 3 divided by 1 plus 3x. We can ignore that divided by 1 in the bottom. Dividing by 1 doesn't change anything. Now plug in 0. See if it's possible. And it is. We get 3 on top and 1 plus 0 on the bottom. So ln of a is equal to 3. That means a is equal to e to the power of 3. And that last step, I'll write down what the reasoning was. If you have log base b of a is equal to c, that means that a is equal to b to the power of c. That's how the inverse functions are defined. And ln means log base e. Or you can exponentiate both sides and use the cancellation law on the left. Questions about any of the steps here? Okay, the next one. Oh, I want to mention, look at your homework list. Your homework list this year is almost the same as the homework list of the students who wrote the exam in 2014. Compare this question to what's on your list, and compare the next one, part B, to what's on your homework list. I think the next one's exactly the same as something in the homework. Nothing's been changed. They do that sometimes. Next question, part B, says find the limit as x approaches 1, 1 divided by the ln of x, minus x over x minus 1. What happens if you plug 1 in the first piece?
Ln of 1 is 0. So you have 1 over 0.
So this looks like one over 0 minus 1 over 0. That's indeterminate. Again, I'd much prefer if they put it in 1 plus, you can say infinity minus infinity, 1 minus negative infinity plus infinity, negative infinity plus infinity if it was a 1 minus. So there's an ambiguity there, but it's definitely indeterminate. What do we do? What should we do? Don't take log of both sides, it won't help this one. We desperately want to use L'Hopital's rule, and we can't. So one thing to try is, can you bring it to a common denominator? The limit as x approaches 1
multiply top and bottom of the first one by x minus 1. So x minus 1, and then x minus 1 times ln of x, minus, multiply top and bottom of the second one by ln of x. So we have x times ln of x divided by x minus 1 times ln of x. Now the denominators are the same. We'll combine the numerators. We have x minus 1 minus x ln of x divided by x minus 1 times ln of x. Now let's check to see what happens if you plug 0 in, or plug 1 in for x. Plug 1 in for x, you'll have 1 minus 1 minus 1 times ln of 1 divided by 1 minus 1 times ln of 1. That's going to be 0 over 0. Pause for celebration. We can use L'Hopital's rule. Equals h. Take the derivative of the top and bottom separately. The derivative of x is 1. The derivative of 1 is 0. The derivative of x ln of x requires a product rule. We'll have the first function times the derivative of the second. X times the derivative of ln of x is 1 over x. Plus the second function, ln of x, multiplied by the derivative of the first. And the derivative of x is 1. Then all divided by. Downstairs, we also need a product rule. We have the first function, x minus 1, multiplied by the derivative of the second, derivative of ln of x is 1 over x, plus the second function, ln of x, multiplied by the derivative of the first, the derivative of x minus 1 is just 1. Let's clean this up a little bit. Limit as x approaches 1 of 1 minus 1 minus ln of x divided by x minus 1 over x plus the ln of x. And x minus 1 over x is the same thing as x over x minus 1 over x, which is 1 minus x to the power of negative 1. We'll do one more cleanup step. When as x approaches 1 of negative ln of x divided by 1 minus x to the power of negative 1 plus ln of x. Questions up to here? What happens if you plug 1 in? What do you get on top?
Ln of 1, 0. What do you get on the bottom? We get, well, 1 to the power of minus 1, that's 1 over 1, plus 1. 1 minus 1, that's 0. 1 over 1, that's another 0. You get 0 over 0 again.
So what do you do? You gotta do it again, sadly. Sure. Okay, so we'll do L'Hopital again. The derivative of minus ln of x is negative 1 over x. And then the derivative of 1 is 0. The derivative of negative x to the power of negative 1 is positive x to the negative 2. Power comes down and gets reduced by 1 plus 1 over x. Now we'll try to plug in 1. We'll get negative 1 on top. 1 over 1 is 1. And then
1 over, so 1 to the power of negative 2 is 1 over 1 squared, which is 1, plus 1 over 1, which is 1. So we get minus 1 over 2, our answer. That is the limit. And is there an easier way to do this?
I don't know.
Not really. It's that 1 over ln of x that makes it hard. Even in 1301. Who's taking 1301 next? You'll learn another way to do limits with power series. You have to do a power series expansion about x is equal to 1. But the 1 over ln of x is going to cause trouble for that. It's possible, but it's just not very friendly. You'd have to use some partial fractions too. There's another topic of 1301. For L'Hopital's rule, is there's only two of them. If you have infinity over infinity or 0 over 0, you take the derivatives of the top and bottom separately. So that's it.
Okay.
That's it. Well, those are the two kinds of limits that allow its use. But if you see something like 1 to the infinity, or infinity minus infinity, or infinity times 0, there are a whole bunch of other ones. There's like 6 or 7 of them. They're all indeterminate. Indeterminate forms, but they don't allow you to immediately use L'Hopital's rule. You have to rewrite the example, rewrite the question, until either you have a different strategy that's clear, or you can rewrite it into a format where L'Hopital's rule is applicable. But so all of those are, in other words, they may eventually invite the L'Hopital's rule application, but as written like that, they don't. You have to rearrange them to use either log rules, or common denominator, or factoring, or other tricks. Like, for example, trigonometry. Writing a reciprocal trig function in terms of sine, cosine, tan, and then seeing if the limit invites the L'Hopital's rule. Next one. You want to do more L'Hopital? Something different. Oh yes, now thank you, I forgot. Bonus question from quiz 6. So, I don't have it in front of me, but I have a pretty good idea what it was. I think it was the limit as x approaches infinity of 2 to the power of x divided by 5 to the power of x plus... Oh, you have it. Sure. That's made a good bonus question. It's so horrible. Plus the sine of 1 over x over 3x plus ln of 1 minus 7 e to the negative x divided by the tan of 5 times e to the negative x. Okay. Each of these components requires a different strategy. So first, we'll write this as three independent limits. Limit of the first plus limit of the second plus limit of the third. We'll try this. Sometimes you can't do this. Sometimes you can't split it up. For example, in the last one, both limits diverged. Both limits gave infinity, or minus infinity, and we needed them combined together to get a nice number. Yeah. In this example, that doesn't happen. Okay, first one. Limit as x approaches infinity of 2 to the x over 5 to the x. That can be rewritten as the limit as x approaches infinity of 2 over 5,
all to the power of x. That's using an exponent law. So that means 2 over 5 to the power of infinity. So 2 over 5 to the power of 10 would be 2 over 5 times 2 over 5 times 2 over 5, which is 0.4 times 0.4 times 0.4. What happens is you multiply by 0.4. Does the result get bigger or smaller? Smaller. So if you multiply by 0.4 infinite times, what are you left with? 0. So that's 0, that piece. Now we'll work on the second piece. If you plug infinity in, so I do this. This is horrible notation, but it's a correct idea. I'm just going to plug infinity as if it was a number. What's 1 over infinity? You take 1 times an infinite number of pieces, 0, divided by 3 times infinity, which is infinity. Okay. What's sine of 0? 0. So you have 0 divided by infinity. What's 0 divided by 10? 0. What's 0 divided by a million? What's 0 divided by infinity? 0. So that's just 0. So 0 plus 0 plus. Okay, now I have to do the last part. So the last part, if you plug infinity in, I'll just do that. What would this look like? You're going to have the ln of 1 minus 7 times e to the power of negative infinity divided by the tan of 5 times e to the negative infinity. And what's e to the negative infinity, or what's anything to any number larger than 1, like 2 to the power of negative infinity? You can rewrite that as 1 divided by e to the positive infinity, again using exponent laws. That's e times e times e times e downstairs. That's 2.7 times 2.7 times 2.7 forever. That's going to be 1 over infinity. That's going to be 0. So this looks like ln of 1 minus 7 times 0, which is 1, divided by the tan of 0. This looks like 0 over 0. So it allows us to use L'Hopital's rule. Take the derivative of the top and bottom separately. Okay, we'll do the bottom first. The derivative of the tan of a function is the secant squared of that function, 5 e to the negative x, multiplied by the derivative of the function inside. That's from the chain rule. And we'll have negative 5 e to negative x. That required a second operation of the chain rule. Questions so far about the third piece and the derivative of the bottom? So a double chain rule for that derivative. And the next one also has a double chain rule. So the derivative of ln of 1 minus 7 e to the negative x, we'll have the top function and bottom function. Again, the derivative of the ln of something is the derivative of that thing inside, that u prime on top, divided by u on the bottom. 1 minus 7 e to the negative x downstairs, and then the derivative of 1 minus 7 e to the negative x upstairs. 0. Then the derivative of negative 7 e to the negative x will be positive 7 e to the negative x. Let's take the derivative of e to the negative x. The derivative of e to the negative x is e to the negative x multiplied by the derivative of negative x, which is negative 1. The negative 1 comes down, cancels each other, and the negative 1 is no longer there. Positive. Okay, I'm going to rewrite this. This is 7 e to the negative x divided by 1 minus 7 e to the negative x all divided by secant squared of 5e to the negative x multiplied by 5e to the negative x. Seven e to the negative x divided by 1 minus 7e to the negative x multiplied by 5e to the negative x times secant squared of 5e to the negative x. The e to the negative x cancels top and bottom. Okay, we have 7 divided by, oh, I forgot all the limits in front. There's still limit as x approaches infinity of all of these. And we have 5 in front, 1 minus 7 e to negative x times secant squared of 5 times e to negative x. And as x goes to infinity, e to the negative x goes to 0. So we'll take the limit. We're going to get 7 divided by 5 times 1 minus 0 times secant squared of 0. Or which negative? Oh. Where'd it go? I lost it, yeah. Good catch. It's supposed to be there. So I'll put the negative up top here. Yes, I lost that negative sign. Okay. So we have negative 7 divided by 5 times secant of 0, secant squared of 0. What's secant of 0? It's 1 over the cos of 0, so 1. So we have 1 squared. Put that down here. Secant of 0 is 1 over the cos of 0, which is 1 over 1, which is 1. So we have negative 7 over 5 is the value of the limit. I think to make this an appropriate difficulty for an exam question would be
both negative x's and positive x's. The limit is x equals negative infinity to 10. Which makes it really a bit easier.
We wouldn't have a double chain rule for the for Monte Carlo. Holy sh! That was a lot of work. One bonus mark. The other ones were also. Knowing that the first one was 0 and the second one was 0, those were also one mark. Okay, next example, next question, what do you want to see? Change this. If we were to make a modification, and let's say this was 1 plus 4i squared over n squared, and this one here was 1 plus 2i over n, and the last piece was 1 plus 8i cubed over n cubed. If we had something like that, we would say a is equal to 1. We would try that setup first. But we don't have any of those in here. We don't have any 1 plus or 2 plus or 3 plus. So what's a? 0. We'll assume it's 0. We'll verify that by making sure all the rest of the pieces fit. Okay, now delta x, from this, it looks like 2i over n is our delta x. So 2i, or not 2i over n, 2 over n is our delta x. Oh, there's not supposed to be an I there. It's supposed to be 2 over n. Delta x should not have I in it. 2 over n. So 2 over n is equal to b minus a over n. So b minus 0 over n. That means b is equal to 2. So we can do the first part of the conversion of the integral. This is the integral from 0 to 2 of f of x dx. Let's go. Now we jump back to x sub I. Do this piece next. X sub I is equal to 0 plus I delta x. So that will be delta x is 2 over n, so that will be 2i over n. Okay. Now we'll compare that to these pieces in here. How does 8i cubed over n cubed relate to x of I? What is that first bracket? How do you create 8i cubed over n cubed from this? What do you do with this to get that? Power 3. So this part looks like arctan of x cubed. What's the second bracket?
4i squared over n squared. What's that equal to?
It's x squared. And what's e to the 2i over n? E to the just x. So that's your inside function. That's your f of x. So this is the integral, and sadly it's not something we can integrate because of the first part. Integral from 0 to 2 of the arctan of x cubed plus x squared times e to the x.
This part can be integrated. This one can't be integrated. As far as I know, doesn't have an antiderivative in terms of elementary functions.
You can integrate it in terms of a power series, though, which is something that you will do at the midway point of the course in 1301. You'll do something called power series, and it'll give you the ability to integrate almost anything, but not give you possibly a very satisfying answer. So this question, by the way, I didn't mention, I didn't tell you where it came from. That's from the OWL page on extra review note 1. So it's stuff that we didn't have time to go through was review like this. I should write down the question.
What year it was? 2015
exam. B28. We want to find the volume that we obtain by taking the two curves, the region that's bounded by x times y is equal to 2 and y is equal to 3 minus x, taking that region and rotating that region about the x-axis. So it's wise to write the first equation as y equals 2 over x. Second equation is already in a nice form. Y is equal to 3 minus x. Make a sketch of those. Well, actually, it's better to find where they cross first. Find the intersection points. So we'll set them equal to each other. 2 over x equals 3 minus x. Cross multiply the x. So 2 is equal to 3x minus x squared. Bring everything over to the left side. So x squared minus 3x plus 2 is equal to 0. And then this has two factors. X, this factors into x minus 2 times x minus 1. So we get two crossing points. X is equal to 2 and x is equal to 1. We can check to see which curve is on top, which curve is on the bottom. So y1, we'll check at 1.5, check at 3 over 2, see which is the top curve and which is the bottom curve. So that'll be 2 divided by 3 over 2, which will be 2 multiplied by 2 thirds, which will be 4 over 3. Now if we check the second curve, y2, that'll be 3 minus 3 over 2. So I picked 3 over 2. It's a number that's between 1 and 2. So they touch, they cross. We'll check a number that's in between to see which one has a higher y value, and that'll be our top function. That'll give us our big radius, and the other one will give us our little radius, furthest from the axis of rotation. So this will be 6 over 2 minus 3 over 2 equals 3 over 2. So the first one, y1, that's the top curve. 2 over x is on top. Okay, so here's our sketch of 2 over x. Just the positive side, the negative side doesn't really help, doesn't help us. And then 3 minus x. That has... a y-intercept of 3, when x is 0, y is 3, and has a negative slope, slope of negative 1. So there's your curve. And this is the region we're looking at, rotating about the x-axis. We'll make just a sketch of this, what this looks like. Kind of like a volcano on its side, or a funnel. If you make cross sections, if you make a cut in the x direction, it's going to look like this, it's going to look like a washer. And if you take that shape and flip it on its side, you're going to have an outer radius, capital R, and an inner radius, little r. And if we sketch that from the graph, it's the distance from the axis of rotation. That's the y distance of the first graph, and the y distance of the second graph, capital R. So capital R is equal to 2 over x. No, what am I doing? Capital R is equal to 3 minus x. And little r is equal to 2 divided by x.
Again,
the big radius is given by the curve that's furthest away from the axis of rotation, and little radius is given by the curve that's closest to the axis of rotation.
Questions about the geometry, about the picture? Yes. Yep. And that's just in case my picture is so terrible, I can't use it to tell which is the top function, which is the bottom function. It's like a backup to that. If you have a really good picture, you don't need to do that. And also, if you do this, you don't even need to do the picture. And this tells you that this is your capital R function, the y1.
Oh, hold on.
I think I misspoke. Let's do a comparison of these two numbers. I just freaked myself out. 4/3 divided by 3/2. So 4/3 versus 3/2 make a common denominator. So multiply top of the first one by 2. We'll have 8/6. Multiply the second one, top and bottom, by 3. We'll have 9/6. Sorry. It does work out. It works out safe. You can't be an idiot like me and not check that this one's bigger. So y2 is the top function, which the picture told us, and I went with the picture. I didn't go with this.
But it will always match up. That whichever one has the higher y value will be the other one's radius, the capital R, because I didn't bother checking. Lazy.
Okay. Now the next part is finding an expression for the volume. Volume is always the integral from a to b of an area function, a of x dx. We're integrating in the x direction
because our washers have a thickness of delta x. We're slicing this way.
The volume we get by multiplying the area, cross-sectional area multiplied by the thickness, that'll give us little volumes. Okay, we're integrating from the lowest x value to the highest x value. That's integrating from 1 to 2. Now we need an area function. Our area function is pi times big radius squared minus little radius squared. That's the area of a washer, the big radius capital R, little radius small r. And that gets plugged into our expression inside the integral. So pi times capital R squared minus little r squared. Now we have to go back to the question and plug in what big R and little r happen to be. So capital R is 3 minus x, and little r is 2/x, so that those both get plugged in. Pi times integral from 1 to 2 of 3 minus x all squared minus 2/x all squared dx. Questions to here? I don't want to do the integral, but I will. I hate subbing in ones and twos into fractions. So we'll have pi times the integral from 1 to 2 of, we'll FOIL out 3 minus x all squared. That'll be 9 minus 6x plus x squared minus 4/x squared, which we'll write as 4 times x to the negative 2 dx. Now we can integrate this term by term. This will be pi times integral of 9 is 9x. Integral of negative 6 times x is negative 6x squared over 2. Integral of x squared is x cubed divided by 3. Integral of negative 4x to the negative 2 is negative 4x to the power of negative 1 divided by negative 1. There's no plus c because there's bounds of integration. I'm going to integrate from 1 to 2. Questions about that step of integrating?
The power increases by 1 and you divide by that new power. Because it's negative, except for
1, x to the power of negative 1, the antiderivative of that is ln of x, or rather ln epsilon value. And I'm going to clean this up a little bit. This is pi times 9x minus 3x squared plus 1/3 x cubed plus 4 over x evaluated from 1 to 2. Now plug in the top bound, 9 times 2, 18, minus 3 times 4, 12, plus 8 over 3, plus 2, minus pi times the bottom bound being plugged in, 9 minus 3, plus 1/3, plus 4. So pi times 18 minus 12, 6, plus 2, 8, plus 8/3, minus pi times 9 plus 10, plus 1/3, so this is going to be pi times 8 minus 10, negative 2, plus 8 over 3 minus 1 over 3 is 7 over 3. I need to make a common denominator. So it's pi times negative 6 over 3 plus 7 over 3 is 1 over 3. So pi over 3 is the answer. And that's what the book has, so it has to be right.
Maybe it's the same way, or maybe.
Oh, they follow it, okay. If you don't want to do the FOIL, what I was expecting to be done, although now I know better, thinking about who wrote them, the person who wrote the solution was my professor, so I'm doing the same thing, I'm doing things the same way that he does them.
I looked at the 2 minus x squared, I was worried that there would be that by substitution, which is the 2 minus x, and it comes out a little bit neater, but it's not necessary to do it that way.
It's better, I think, to FOIL it. More straightforward. Questions about any of these steps from the beginning to the end? X to the power 1/2. Then take the derivative, du by dx is 1/2 times x to the negative 1/2. So du by dx is 1 over 2 times the root of x. Using exponent laws, x to the negative 1/2 is 1 over x to the positive 1/2. And we can convert that back to a square root.
What is root x? I'm looking at what root x is down there. You replace it with u.
So du by dx is equal to 1 over 2u. Let's isolate for dx. Dx is equal to 2u multiplied by du. I will use that to replace the dx inside the question. This dx gets replaced by 2u du. So our integral becomes the integral of secant squared, we replace the root of x with a u, replace the root x on the bottom with a u, and replace the dx with a 2u du. Questions up to here? I know the book does it differently. I don't know if you look at YouTube, you'll find it done differently.
What YouTube will do, what other people will do, is they'll say, they'll isolate for dx at this step here. They'll say dx divided by root of x is 2 times du, and they'll replace the dx divided by that root x with a 2 du.
they get the same thing. I like to replace the dx because it's less magical. Okay. The u's on top and bottom cancel. And you're left with the integral of secant squared of u du. That is on your list. What is the antiderivative of secant squared of u? So the derivative of what function gives you secant squared? Yep. Tan. This is going to be tan of u. What's missing? Something's missing, so we'll put the u in, put the root of x in for u. If this is a long answer question, how many marks would it be? Yeah, missing that. It'd be probably 6 marks, or 4 marks, or I think 4 marks. So, what's missing? Oh, missing the 2, thank you. The 2 is missing. I forgot about the 2 there. So we have a 2 times tan of u, 2 times tan of root of x, and plus c. 2 things are missing. The constant, I lost the 2, and the plus c. And the reason why the c is there is because there's no bounds of integration. You get an arbitrary constant. You want to do another one like this? Another integration by substitution? Okay. Okay. Think of a good one. I hope this one works. Integral of the sine of 2e to the x divided by cos of e to the x and then e to the x on top dx. Oh, this is a really tough one. Because you can start the wrong way. What would you like to try? Let u equal, what do you want? Sorry? Yeah. Let u equal e to the x. Then du by dx is equal to e to the x. So dx is equal to du divided by e to the x. And now we'll do a substitution of the dx and the integral with that expression. So this becomes the integral of the sine of 2u divided by the cos of u times u, or times, I'll just leave it as e to the x. Then we have du divided by e to the x, and e to the x is canceled top and bottom. So that's the integral of the sine of 2u divided by the cos of u du. Now what? How do you proceed from here? And the hint is this has nothing to do with substitution. Exactly. It's a trick. Trick question. Yeah, you need a trig identity.
sine of 2u is 2 times sine of u cosine of u. So this becomes the integral of 2 sine u cosine u divided by cosine of u du, and the cosine of u cancels top and bottom. So it's 2 times integral of the sine of u du. Antiderivative of sine, what's that? Negative cos. A lot of mistakes were made on the quiz with this. Just getting the signs flipped. That's okay, it happens. Plus c, because there's no bounds of integration. And then the last step is put everything back in terms of x. Put the negative in front as well, negative 2 times the cos of e to the x plus c. I'll do a quick check. Let's check and make sure this answer is correct. If our answer, A, is equal to negative 2 times the cos of e to the x, A prime will be, if you take the derivative of the cos of something, you get the negative sine of that thing. The negative cancels the negative that's already in front. You have 2 times the sine of e to the x multiplied by the derivative of the inside, derivative of e to the x of e to the x. And if you go back to the very beginning and use that identity,
sine of 2 e to the x, replace that with the sine of 2 times the sine of e to the x times the cos of e to the x. Cos of e to the x is canceled right at the very beginning, and you will get that expression.
So you get something that's the same. Take the derivative of the answer, you can get what's inside the integral back. But to see that, you have to use the trig identity at the beginning. Another one like this, or easier? This is too hard for an exam. Easier? I like to show you some examples a little bit tougher, so when you see your actual exam question, say, hey, it isn't that bad. Okay, integral Here's an example that's at the appropriate level of difficulty. If it works. Yeah, it'll work. What do you try? What do you want to do here? Yeah, let u equal 1 of x. Let's try that. Then du by dx, the derivative of ln of x is 1 over x. Isolate for dx. Dx is equal to x times du, so cross multiply in both directions. And now we'll do a substitution. Replace the dx with that expression. So we have the integral of the sine of u over x multiplied by x times du. Now the x's cancel top and bottom, and this gives us the integral of the sine of u du. And as before, as in the previous example, the antiderivative of the sine of u is the negative cosine of u plus c, which will be the negative cosine of the ln of x plus c. Undo the substitution. The real reason why I did the above one is to remind you about that trig identity, that someone involved in the course really, really likes that identity. And it's not me. More integration, or is it a different topic? Another one, Light? Sorry? Sure.
All kinds. There's the ones with geometry, which are a pain. The pain is set up, and then there's the ones.
What other type is there? Almost all of them are geometry. There's a few business examples, but those are not very popular. Because you don't have to make the function. The function is usually given to you. Can you pick one from the book, or from one from prior exam, or from the quiz prep? Which one? You need those. You don't need all of them. But you definitely need sine squared of x plus cos squared of x is equal to 1. You definitely need that square of gain.
Sine of 2x is c times x cos of x. That's square of gain. And the cos 2x in there is the three different forms that I could take. Those are all very different. Yeah. And then trig identities for those. Oh yeah, yeah. That's definitely part of the course. Right. Inverse trig functions, like solving for x, that kind of thing.
You know, like I think you don't like identity of a cosine inverse. You know, like tan inverse and cosine inverse.
Oh,
what
well, the derivatives are.
Yeah.
You need those. Yeah.
Is that from the case, right?
Well. So let's say you have y equals. You're talking about these things, the square root of 1 minus x squared, right? Looking at integrating this kind of function?
Yeah.
Yeah, you have to have this one memorized. But this is arcsine plus c. Likewise, the integral of 1 over 1 plus x squared, that's arctan of x plus c. And those both come from the derivatives. The derivative of arc sine is 1 over the square root of 1 minus x squared, and the derivative of arc tan is 1 over 1 plus x squared. Yep. Well, there is a spot in the book. I think it's 5.4, I can't remember what section it's in. There's a table of integrals. I can find it. Yep. 5.4, page 403. Those ones, except the bottom two. Do not worry about sine h and cos h, hyperbolic sine and cos. They're not part of the course. I don't think they ever work. But the rest of these in here you have to know. Okay, so that's the integral, right? So 2013, number 31, it's asking, okay, 2012, long answer question. That's 2012, number 31. Oh, the 1:30, 1 o'clock and 1:30. Okay. At 1 p.m., the ship A is 15 kilometers due north of ship B. This is going to be a question where we have to draw two diagrams. So at 1 p.m., yes. So here's point A for ship A. It's 15 kilometers due north of ship B. So ship A is north of ship B. It's above it. So at this particular time, this distance is 15. And then ship A is sailing west at 16 kilometers per hour. So it's going to the left. So A prime is equal to 16 kilometers per hour. And ship B is sailing north at 18 kilometers per hour. So B prime, rate of change of B, is it's getting closer. So it's making the distance between B and A smaller. And we're going to call this, well, let's not call it B. Let's call it H. So that's A prime, which, well, let's not call it A prime, B prime. Let's label the diagram. We'll call the X direction, we'll call that L. And the Y direction, we'll call it H. And the hypotenuse, we'll call D. So the rate of change of H, H prime, the rate of change of the vertical distance between the two objects, the two points, that's getting smaller with time. So the rate of change of that quantity is negative. So H prime is negative. What is it? What number is it? Sailing north, 18. So negative 18. And then ship A, so that's L prime. The rate of change of the distance L is getting bigger, so positive 16 kilometers per hour. And then it says, at what rate is the distance between the two ships changing at 1:30 p.m.? So this picture is at 1 o'clock p.m. We need a new picture at 1:30. So in 30 minutes, in half of an hour, ship A has moved how far? If it's going 16 kilometers in 1 hour, how far has it gone in half of an hour? 8. Half of, one half of 16. And ship B, ship B has moved 18 over 2, has moved 9 kilometers up. So we draw a new picture. It's still H, L, and D. I'm solving it differently than what's in the book, probably. Doesn't matter. L prime is still the same. L prime is still positive 16. H prime is still negative 18. Now, what's L, though? What's the new horizontal distance? It started out, they're perfectly collinear. Not collinear, they're perfectly vertical separation from each other. So L started out at 0. And in that 30 minutes, ship A has moved 8, so to the left. So now L is equal to 8 at this instant. And ship B has moved up. So the horizontal distance is going to change. It was 15.
But it's made that distance smaller. It was 15 plus by 9, so that would be 15 minus 9.
So 6. So our new picture, we have 8 here, 6 here, and d here. Pythagorean theorem tells us that d squared is equal to 8 squared plus 6 squared. So d squared is equal to 64 plus 36. D squared is equal to 100. So d is equal to 10. That's the hard part, by far, is setting this thing up. Questions to this point? Notice that left versus right do not come into play. I didn't say it's west. There's a negative direction, the negative x direction, and east is positive x to the bottom. Then you say, well, it's positive, south is negative. Don't bother. Please don't do that. Don't think in that way. That's silly. Don't do it. Yeah. These quantities are labeled in terms of what is this total distance? And the derivative of these quantities is telling me is the distance getting bigger or is the distance getting smaller. So keeping track of, does this contribution make the quantity bigger or does it make the quantity smaller? The fact that shift D is moving north makes that horizontal, makes that height, that distance H, makes it smaller. So it's a negative derivative. Likewise, the shift moving to the left makes the distance L larger, so it's a positive derivative. If you set it up left versus right as negative versus positive, and north versus south as negative versus positive, you'll get the same answer. So you'll have to just keep track of vector-like quantities. If you've taken grade 12 physics, it's okay. If you haven't taken grade 12 physics, please do it this way. What do we do next? We haven't done any calculus yet. We just did geometry. What's the next thing we do? Right. We're going to start there again. We have d squared is equal to h squared plus l squared. And the question wants, at what rate is the distance between the two ships changing at this time? So we're going to take derivatives implicitly. These are all functions of time. There's a hidden variable t inside all of these. We're going to take the derivative with respect to t. This is a function all squared. We're going to take the derivative of f squared, and get 2 times f times f prime. We're going to take the derivative of d squared, and get 2 times d prime. Likewise, for the other two sides, 2 times h prime plus 2 times l prime. Now we're going to plug in all the stuff. Well, we can cancel the 2s, divide both sides by 2, and then isolate for d prime. D prime is equal to h times h prime plus l times l prime, all divided by d. And now we can start plugging stuff in. H is 6 times h prime is negative 18 plus l is 8 times l prime is positive 16, all divided by 10. Let's see.
Divide 2 out from the top. So divide everything on top by 2, everything on the bottom by 2. This 18 becomes 9, 16 becomes 8, it becomes 5.
Just to make the multiplication easier, 6 times negative 9 plus 8 times, divide the 16 by 2, so 8. All divided by 5. And that's going to be, can we simplify any more? No, we can't. So negative 54 plus 64 all over 5. That'll be positive 10 over 5, which is 2 kilometers per hour. That's a little pass. Does it do it the same way? Kind of. More linear, more all in one continuous step. I have it all over the place. Questions about the setup again? If you want to go back through that, it's okay. Yeah, I don't have anything pre-cooked. It's better that way, because I don't really know what bothers you the most from the course. I prefer if you guys are in charge of the review sessions, I prefer that format. I'll pause this. There's a whole bunch of them. We proved two of them. The first one, the sum from I equals 1 to n of a constant c. That's adding up c n times. So c plus c plus c n times. That'll be c multiplied by n. The second one, sum from I equals 1 to n of I. That's 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 all the way up to n. And we proved in class that's equal to n times n plus 1 over 2. The third one, we did not prove in class. You can prove it geometrically. It's a pain to do. I don't recommend doing it until you have lots of free time. You have nothing better to do, which may be never in your life. The answer is n times n plus 1 times 2n plus 1 all over 6. And then the last one from this section, sum from I equals 1 to n of I cubed, and that's n times n plus 1 over 2 all squared. You can prove that one from geometry as well. A lot tougher. More paper, more time. Less fun. Much less fun. I know I have not done this one.
I looked at the proof, but no, I better do. I did this one. I did this piece of paper and I wasted a few hours, so I can never have back.
And there's more. There's some kinds of summation formulas that don't follow from this routine. Here is one of them. What's the sum from I equals 1 to n of 1 over n plus 1 minus 1 over n? Oh, sorry, 1 over I plus 1 minus 1 over I. So this doesn't look like any of these. It's not so much a formula as it is a strategy. If you see a weird question that doesn't look like I squared, I cubed, chances are it's the kind of question that you answer by writing out the first three terms and the last three terms, looking for patterns, looking for cancellations. So this will be equal to term 1 plus term 2 plus term 3 plus dot 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 dot. Term n will be the last one. Then term n minus 1 will be the second last term. And term n minus 2 will be the third last term. So let's write down what those are. Term 1 is what you get when you let I equal 1. So you'll have 1 over 1 plus 1, which is 1 over 2. Minus 1 over 1 plus, now we'll do the second term. Term 2 is when we let I equal 2. That'll be 1 over 3. Sorry. Yeah, 1 over 3. What am I doing? 1 over 2. Hold on. Yeah, 1 over 3 minus 1 over 2. Now we need the third term, which is 1 over 4 minus 1 over 3. So those are the first three terms, plus dot, dot, dot. Now the last three terms, dot, 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 plus. The last one is when we let I equal n. That'll be 1 over n plus 1 minus 1 over n. The second last term, is when we let I equal n minus 1. So it'll be 1 over n minus 1 subtracted from 1 over n. And then the third last term will have 1 over n minus 2 subtracted from 1 over n minus 1. Right, now you look for cancellations.
You have a positive 1 half and a negative 1 half. Those are going to cancel. And nothing cancels with the negative 1. Something does cancel with the 1 third.
This 1 third will cancel this minus 1 third.
What's going to happen to the 1 quarter?
And you could, if you're not sure, get the next term. You'll find that it does cancel. Likewise, this 1 over n is going to cancel with this 1 over n. This 1 over n minus 1 is going to cancel with that n 1 over n minus 1. And 1 over n minus 2 will cancel with 1 over n minus 2 over here. So what are you left with? Two terms survive. The negative 1 and the 1 over n plus 1 survive. So you're going to get negative 1 plus 1 over n plus 1. We can make a common denominator. So that'll be negative bracket n plus 1 divided by n plus 1 plus 1 over n plus 1, and then combine the numerators. Negative n minus 1 plus 1 all over n plus 1. So you get negative n divided by n plus 1. That's your answer. It's called a telescoping series. Is anyone interested in seeing another type of, like this, another variety? So I don't mean like switching it so it's 1 over I plus 2 minus 1 over I. Same kind of format. You'll have lots of stuff will survive at the end. You'll have three pieces will survive, or four. I can't remember. But I'd have to work it out. You want to see a different type, though. Something with similar strategy, you have to write out the pieces. I'm curious. Testable. No, not a proof, but something like this. Another kind of example that you don't have a summation formula for. No, there's some that have like three or four pieces. I'll set it up. I'll set up one like this that has that. But they won't test, they can't test those. That would be this sum from I equals 1 to n of 1 over I minus 1 over I plus 2. You'll find that there's two terms at the beginning that will survive and two terms at the end that will survive. So go through that on your own if you're curious. That's for 1301. If you're headed off there, please do this question. If you're not going to calc 1301, do this at your leisure for fun. Okay, what I'm thinking of is this. Sum from I equals 1 to 100 of the 10 of pi times I over 4. So do I want 100 or 101? Hold on. 1 to 2. Hold on. We can do sine. Of pi over 2 plus I pi. No, not going to be good either. Give me one that works nicely. secant. Secant of pi times pi.
From pi equals 1 to 100.
So let's write out the first few terms. This is going to be the secant of pi plus the secant of 2 pi plus the secant of 3 pi plus dot 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 dot. What will the last three terms be? The last one will be the secant of 100 pi. The second last one will be the secant of 99 pi. And the third last one will be the secant of 98 pi. Okay, what is the secant, first of all, of just pi? That's 1 over the cos of pi. What's the cos of pi? Not 0, not 1, negative 1. 1 over negative 1, so you get negative 1 from that first piece. So this is a negative 1 here. Secant of 2 pi. What's that? 1 over the cos of 2 pi. What's the cos of 2 pi? Positive 1. So you get a positive 1 there. Negative 1, a positive 1. What's the next one? What's the secant of 3 pi? What do you think? Negative 1. And the next one will be positive 1. How about secant of 100 pi? Is that plus or minus? Plus. Secant of 99, plus or minus? Minus. 98, plus. What are you going to end up with? What do you think? So add them up in pairs.
1 and 2 added together give you 0.
So those two combine to give you nothing. Negative 1 and positive 1. So that all together is 0. And then 3 pi and 4 pi together will give you 0. So if you're taking the next number,
an odd number, plus an odd power, an odd multiple of pi, plus an even multiple of pi. So odd, even. You get up to 99, and you get to 98. 98 cancels to 97. 99,
so what are you left with? What's your answer? 0. Okay. And what if it was I equals 1 to 99? What are you going to get? We get minus 1. Here's where we have to be really careful. Sum from I equals 0 to n of secant of I times pi. We'll go to n, we'll go to 100. What's this equal to?
We're not starting at 1 anymore, we're starting at 0. What do you think we're going to get?
Nope,
not going to get 0 anymore.
We're going to get positive 1. Write it out. You have secant of 0 first, plus the secant of 1 times pi, plus the secant of 2 pi, plus dot dot dot, dot dot dot, plus the last one will be the secant of 100 pi, secant of 99 pi before that, and secant of 98 pi before that. So we have an even power, 0 times pi, plus the odd power, 1 times pi. Those cancel out, give you 0. And then you have an even and an odd, The next pair cancel out to give you 0. At the end, you have an even and an odd, 98 and 99 canceling out to give you 0. And this one doesn't pair up. No pair. There's nothing to cancel it. So you end up with positive 1. And your answer instead of as 0. So starting your sum at 0, your answer is giving you this extra piece of the beginning you did not have before. In other words, taking it. I call this looking for patterns. It's not really calculus. It's something that's needed for calculus. You were looking for patterns before you were walking, before you were talking. First thing you do as a living human being is you look for patterns. This is the generalization of that. A really, really horrible one. More of these or a different topic? Oh, it's time up, I gotta go soon. So who's coming to the next one? Who's coming to the next prep? Okay, come armed with questions. Come armed with a big list. I am gonna post this video, so if you can't make any of these whole